And we're live! Woohoo! Welcome along, everybody, to the live stream. For those that have randomly stumbled upon this, either live or in the recordings, if you're watching the recording. Hello, recording people, if you're watching in the future. Hello, live people, if you're watching now. I'm Gavin Hoey. This is my channel, actually. I can kind of... You might have noticed the music, with someone putting the music, was different. Yeah, that's it, you see. That's how we tell the difference on my channel and everything else. Yeah. Anyway, so welcome along to the live stream. This is completely live, so if you want to pop something in the chat, that's great. If you've got some questions, pop some questions in as we go along. We've got a few questions we're going to answer. But first of all, I'm not on my own in here. I do have some assistance apart from the amazing Polly. You can see them and you can hear them. I've got Sam on the comments and Freya on the Super Switcher.
Hi, everyone. How's everyone doing? We've got lots of people here.
Have we?
Yeah, it's
really?
Great. Yeah. Shall I give some shout-outs to some countries?
Yeah, please do.
So, now, Trini Photo was here, like, super, super early. So,
they get the first mention.
Yeah. Trinidad and Tobago, very exotic. So we've got Peru, Denmark, we've got Germany, the Philippines, New Jersey, Finland, Nebraska, everywhere.
I'm literally gonna say everywhere.
Literally everywhere.
Fantastic. So fantastic. Thank you very much for joining me. And as I say, if you're watching the recording, thank you for watching the recording. You can put comments down in the recorded version. But if you're live, hey, bonus, you get to put actual live chat in and Sam will fire over the relevant questions as and when we get to something interesting worth questioning, I suppose. So what am I going to be doing? That's a good question. So yesterday-ish, we put a thing on my Instagram, I say we because Freya did the hard work, saying, what would you like to know? If there's a question you want to know, ask it there. We were swamped. We've got so many questions. We've got enough to do this video and some other ones. Some we've picked out and we're going to actually make whole videos about your question. Some of them are going to go on Adorama. They were such good questions. And then some just seem to be good to group together. So we've grouped together 6 or 7 questions about Flash for this demonstration. Yeah, because there was just loads and loads and loads of questions about Flash. So that's what we're going to be covering, various questions about Flash and shallow depth of field and stuff like that. Yes.
I'm waving at him because this has caught my eye. We've got Scuba Steve here. My first time catching the live stream here from Virginia Beach. Hey, Scuba Steve. Love it.
Obviously on dry land because Wi-Fi doesn't work underwater. Yes. Useless information. Anyway, hi, Scuba Steve. Thanks for joining us. Right, okay, so should we do the first question, Freya? I'm going to grab my camera. You do the first question.
Yeah, thanks so much, everyone, for your answers. Well, they were so helpful.
Well, did they give you answers?
Well, no, what, to the original question.
Oh, I see. Like, fantastic. I can take the rest of this off.
Already, yeah. They don't know the questions and they've answered them. Yeah, so let's start off then. Question one.
Yes.
This is from Michelle? Oh, sorry, I'm going to struggle with all of these names. Every name but my own I will struggle with. Perez, who said, what camera settings do you use on a portrait session?
Okay, brilliant question. So what camera settings do I use? So I'm going to plug myself... I'm on a very short leash. Hang on a second. I'm going to plug myself in and show you my camera settings. Bear with me. This has all the recipe for a really bad idea when you actually go live. Right, so... yeah, I haven't really thought this through. Okay, I've realised now I can't see anything until Frey presses the button that says, there you are, because my camera won't let me see my menu on my camera anymore. So this is actually my camera. Look, there they are. Give them a wave. Yay! Marvellous. So this is actually my camera. So the first thing I'm going to tell you is if I'm going to do anything with Flash, I'm going to be right here where it says M for manual mode. So manual mode is my default setting. Okay, so everything Flash, I'm always on manual mode. That's because I'm in a studio. Even when I'm out on location, I generally work in manual mode. Back in the days when we used to do weddings, that was something I might have changed. But yeah, nowadays everything's manual mode. So that's the first thing to change. Let's work across the top. So the next thing is the shutter speed. Now the shutter speed, I'm going to be at my camera's flash sync speed. Now your mileage may vary, but I'm going to be at 250th of a second. So that is my camera. Today we're using an OM system, OM 1 Mark II, and that is my camera's flash sync speed. Yours will be different. If you don't know, Google it. You'll get the answers there. If you really don't know, probably 160 will be just fine. But 250 is where I'm going to be. Next, I'm going to change my aperture. And this is where things start to become a lot more of a personal preference sort of thing. So I'm going to change mine. I like to be around about f5.6. Now, bearing in mind, I'm using the Micro Four Thirds system today, which means I'm using wider angle lenses than you would be on a full frame system. You might find you want to be more like f8, f11 as just a default setting. It depends how much depth of field you want, because that's one of the factors that influences depth of field. And then ISO. So my ISO is not going to be 3200. It's going to be right down here. Now, my camera's default ISO is 200, and that's actually where I would put it, whatever camera I've got. If you go to ISO 100, then you have no problems at all, but your flash has to work twice as hard as ISO 200. So the flash has to be a whole stop brighter, the battery lasts half as long, the amount of heat is increased, all of those bits and pieces, okay? A couple of other things to change. Let's come down to this one right here. So this is subject detection. I'm getting old. Anything that can make my life easier is good news. So I'm going to be on human because this is the OM system, OM 1 Mark II. It used to be face and eye detect, but in their infinite wisdom, they have removed that. And now it's just called human. Let's not go down that route. So that's important. You'll notice that this is flash and it's turned off. Can you see there's a little like no entry sign through the flash? And I can't change that by pressing any of the buttons here. And that's because my camera is set to single shot silent mode. So whatever camera you have, by and large, there's always exceptions, go for single shot mechanical. If you can't hear the click, you're not going to see anything as far as flash goes. You can see now it's unlocked. And I like to be in single AF rather than continuous AF. Okay, so those are my basic settings. They're gonna vary. Oh, there's one more. Nearly forgot, look, white balance. Auto white balance, not a good place. If you're on auto white balance, what will happen, by coming out here, is it'll, oh yes, I'll explain about this in a second, is it'll try and do the white balance that it sees for the room light and not flash. So you could set your white balance to flash if you want to. I like to set mine to a custom white balance, and I generally go for 5200. It works well for my lens camera combination, but you might find you want something warmer or colder. That's absolutely fine. All right, so those are my camera settings. Hopefully that helps everybody get up to speed. I got another question though, so unrelated to this, there was a, can we turn this off a minute, Frey? Thanks very much. That's weird, isn't it? Somebody sent me an email. I get emails every now and again, and by and large, I can't reply to them because just life. It's a very long shot, but Mason Bullington. Mason Bullington, if you're in the house, it's a long shot. But Mason emailed me and said, really long email. I mean, really long email. But the crux was, I wanted to know how you're supposed to get focus on your subject when your screen is black. Anyone had that before? You've put your flash settings in, your screen goes completely black. Have you had that? So, Mason, if you're watching or somehow you managed to find this live, oh God, that's connected. Don't break the HDMI port, that'd be really bad. So let me come and throw this up here. So if you, I mean, can you wave at the other end? Can you see them? No, it's really bad. So the camera settings I've dialed in for a reason, and they are to get control of the room lights. So if I come over here and try to find Polly, I mean, she's there, but you can't really see her. So what I need to do is to have some magic button that if I pressed it would do that. Wouldn't that be good? Okay, so that's what you're looking for. You're looking for the magic button that turns this into that. Yeah, it's a bit wobbly, but that's what you're after. So if you're struggling with a black viewfinder, it's going to be called a few things. Let's see if I can find it on my screen. I've set mine as a custom button, which is why I'm able to do it so quick. And I know I was watching Seth do WPPI, Nikon stage, and I know he's done exactly the same thing. So this is a feature you might want to consider putting as a custom button. So I can turn on SOVF, which is, what's the S stand for? I don't know. Oh, but optical viewfinder, simulated optical viewfinder.
Yeah, someone's just put that actually. Gary put exposure simulator.
That's it. It's called all sorts. It used to be called live. What was it? Live view boost. It used to be called. If you've got an OM1, doesn't work on an OM1. You've got to use Night LV, and also if you're connected to HDMI, it doesn't work either. So you have to use Night LV. So there's various ways around it, but by and large, whatever camera you've got, you'll find somewhere in the menu an optical viewfinder replicator. Because back in the days before mirrorless, we didn't have this problem because we were looking through physical optics. It also meant we had no idea of the exposure or the white balance until we took a picture. Pluses and minuses, I guess. So yeah, so that's a feature. Look out for that. Turn that on, and then you'll be able to see what's going on through your viewfinder, like that. Okay. So yeah, that feature. Okay. So let's get rid of this because I'm going to need to connect that up to that. So there we go. That's the first question. How do I set up my camera? What's my go-to settings? Of course, my settings are going to change. They're never fixed, but those are my starting things. Things that tend not to change are my flash sync speed and my ISO. Other things like white balance I'll shift, and I'll also shift my aperture quite a lot, which kind of leads us on to the next question. Go on, Frey, what's the next question?
Okay, next question is from Luca Veneris, who said, what's the need to pay for a fast f1.2 lens if most of the time best focus comes at f8?
Brilliant question. I like that question. That is my sort of question. Why on earth would you pay for a fast lens? So this little tiny lens here is an f1.2 lens. I mean, trust me, it is. I know, compared to a full frame camera, it's minuscule. And you look at it and you think, how is that like £1,000 worth of, £1,000, which is some dollars and other currencies. Yeah, it's a lot. Basically, it's a lot of money for what is effectively not a particularly big lens. And if I spend most of my time shooting at f5.6 or f8, why would I bother getting one? Why would you get one? Let me know, pop it in the comments. Why would you buy an f1.2 lens? What's the point of this lens? I mean, there is a point. it's not all bad news. So let's set some images up. Whilst you're having a little think about that. Okay, so let's put Polly back there.
I do have another question.
Yeah, I'll go for it.
This is from Nate. How do I know when I need a bigger flash?
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually. How do you know when you need a bigger flash? I guess the answer is when you get to about half power, I would suggest. If you're reaching half power on a regular basis, then, and I'm assuming by bigger you mean more output of light, then you've got to start thinking about how am I going to make that light bigger? Because half power is kind of my maximum. You never want to run it at full power. It takes too long to recycle was one example. So anytime you're running at half power regularly, not just one off, but you know, like regularly, think about doubling your flash power. So if you're on a 200 watt second, think about going up to 400, because doubling your flash power from 200 to 400 is the potential for one more stop of light. Or in other words, going from half power to a quarter power. Okay, so that's kind of a quick and generic answer. Okay, let me just set my camera up. Okay, we'll just see if we get a picture coming into the screen. Bear with me. Okay, I can hear something go flash. I can see something go pop. Good. Okay, so I'm going to set my camera up. I'm going to shoot at the exact settings I said. I'm going to get my flash meter and...
So you've got some answers.
Yeah, please. Let's fire them in.
Sharpness.
Yeah.
Chris said ego.
Yes, Chris.
Biggie Z, because you never know when you'll need a 1.2 till you need it.
Exactly.
And then better to have it than not. Yeah, that's it.
I mean, actually, I think those are better than I was going to do. Yeah, I like the ego one. I've never met a photographer with ego. I don't know what you're talking. Right, where are we? Let's take a picture. So these are the settings that I recommended for you. And if it pops on the screen, I'll make it nice and big so you can see it. All right, okay. Perfectly okay. So this is taken with effectively the kit lens at f5.6. My settings dialed in f5.6. Isn't it lovely? It looks good. Let's take that lens away. And that's at not quite 40 millimeters, but close enough. And I'll try and do the same shot with an f1.2 lens. So this is now an f1.2 lens. I'm going to set exactly the same settings. Nothing's going to change. I'll try and frame it up roughly the same. Okay, here we go. From my side of things, it felt the same. I couldn't see any difference through the viewfinder. It didn't make any particular difference. And this is the kit lens. This is the very expensive f1.2 prime lens. I don't know, other than me getting them slightly wonky, can you see any difference? What about if we go in close? Bearing in mind that YouTube live streamed takes time to render the images. I'd say they are identical, as near as damn it. Okay, so if you put them in lab tests, maybe there'd be a bit of difference in vignetting at the edges, but it's very, very unlikely. The short answer to your question is there is no point buying an f1.2 lens if you spend most of your time in a well-lit studio doing f5.6 or f8. No point at all. Save your money, spend it on hiring a good model or makeup artist or whatever. Because you're not using the lens what it was designed to be used for. The important thing with f1.2 lenses is you want to be at f1.2. That's it, isn't it? That is literally the most important thing. So if I change my lens and let's see, let's just pop a couple of images in. Hang on a second. Okay. So f5.6, bear with me, 1.2. Okay. So, a little bit dark for some bizarre reason, but hey, it's alive. But this is f1.2. Can you see the background on this one is lovely and soft? That's f5.6. Can you see the background is in focus? That is why you would get an f1.2, because you want to throw the background out of focus and you're in a small studio and the distance between the background and the subject is, put me on full screen, Frey, as big as your screen. I'm so glad I could get that. You should see, you can't see, you can see, but they're, honestly, they're giving me the thumbs up back there and they're going, nailed that, awesome, well done. It's as big as your screen. It's not, it's about 2 feet. Or about a meter and a bit, no, less than a meter. Yeah, about the size of your screen. I think, actually, do you know what? If it is 24 inches, it probably is about the same size as some people's screen.
That's a first that's ever worked for you.
I know. Anyway, that's beside the point. So, not a lot of room. Now, if you had more space, we could get Polly and put her over here. Unfortunately, you can't see this, but again, every time. But the wall is over here. The wall's over here. Don't worry, it's fine. So I can't. I don't have the room to do that. I have to make the use of what I've got. So if you had more space, you could use f2.8 and still get a blurry background. You have to live with the space that you've got. Okay, so let's pop that there. Anyone interested to know whether it still works? No one's interested, are they?
No one's noticed. It's fine.
I don't know what anyone's talking about. Let's have a little look. I'm interested. Oh my goodness me. Everything is out of... Oh no, wait a minute. In focus if you press the button. Oh, actually, that's a good picture. Yeah, look at that. That's look at that. That's art, isn't it? That's quite arty. I like that. Okay. Yep, still a little underexposed, but... Any camera manufacturers want me to test their cameras to destruction? I am available and experienced. Okay. So that's kind of why you'd want an f1.2. That kind of leads us on to one of the other questions. Go for it, Frey.
Okay. The next one.
Yes.
By Am Saeed, is there any advantage to shooting high-speed sync in a studio setting?
Okay. Is there any advantage to shooting high-speed sync in a studio setting? Yes. Okay, and it's kind of what I've been showing you, because if I take my camera and my lens and I dial in those settings, ISO 200, 250th of a second, f1.2, and I take a picture of Polly, here we go, then what I get is basically That. That is no flash firing whatsoever. Let me just reset my, there we go, EVF. Good, I can see it. It's like, everything's a bit blurry. Managed to knock the diopter. Okay, so that is the ambient light. That is the ambient light that I'm recording in this studio. Now, when we're doing flash, if you watch any of our tutorials, you'll notice that we do a picture that where we say no flash, no picture. Okay, so if I dial in f5.6, for example, and I take the same picture, no flash, basically no picture. And the reason we do that is because we don't want this picture. We don't want uncontrolled light. Now, by coincidence, the light in here is actually quite good. It's quite directional light. But usually, it's light from the windows pouring through, or light that you don't want, or maybe it's different coloured light. There's a whole bunch of reasons why having uncontrolled light in your scene is a bad idea, which is why we try and do this, no flash, no picture. So, that's where high-speed sync flash comes in, because I've got to get back there. So let's leave the flash transmitter off. F1.2, 250th. I'll take a bunch of pictures and we'll try and take the same one. So this is, let's go to that one. That's 250th F1.2 ISO 200. 500th of a second is going to be this one. 1,000th of a second, nothing else is changing, is going to be this picture. 2,000th of a second will look like this. 4,000th of a second will look like this. But you get the idea. As I'm increasing my shutter speed, so the room light is becoming less and less part of the picture. Now, we've got incredibly bright video lights in here, so you can actually see the video without me having to crank the ISO up on the video cameras so high, it looks horrible. So this is a little bit unworldly, it's not quite right. And Polly is a little bit pale. She doesn't get out the studio much. She could do with a bit of a tan. So she is unusually bright in that respect. So by and large, when I'm working with real people in here, 2,000th of a second, f1.2, ISO 200 is my go-to setting. The trouble is this. Oh, not that. I might see. Hang on a second. Let's jump over here. I'm going to unplug a couple of bits. Let's see if this will work. 1 million. I haven't tried this. This could be a genius or an absolute disaster. Let's plug that in here. Nothing could possibly go wrong at this point. There we go. Okay, so Freya, if you can go back to my camera. Okay, here we go. So those are the settings. There they are. Look. Manual mode, 2,000th of a second, f1.2, ISO 200. I know these are going to take control of the room lights, so the room lights won't be recorded. But when I switch my flash transmitter on, it's going to do that? No, okay, there we go. When I switch my flash transmitter on, can you see that it just changed automatically to 250th of a second? That's really hard to make it stay on the screen because it wants to go off the screen. I'll do it this way around. There we go, that works. So 2,000th of a second, but when I turn my transmitter on, it automatically changes itself to 250th of a second. I want to be on 2,000th of a second, and it doesn't matter what I do, I can't get past that. It's stuck. I can't, it just won't work. I can go down, but I can't go up. I'm stuck at 250th of a second. That's because the flash transmitter knows what camera it's attached to. Let me unplug this. Yep, there we go. Screen's gone black. Oh, phew. It's like somebody dropped a camera or something stupid. Who'd do that? It's like the flash transmitter knows. So when you buy a flash transmitter, you might get a smart one like I've got here with multiple pins that match your camera. You might get a dumb one with just a single transmitter pin in the center. But these intelligent ones are designed to go onto specific camera brands. So they fit the pins on the top and they communicate with the camera and say, oh yes, I have a flash on top, so I need to be at the flash sync speed and no more. It's a safety feature. So if I want to go past it, I have to press a button on here. Let me do this back to front and see if I can make it brighter for you. There we go. I have to press this little sync button down here. And can you see the little H pops on the screen? Can you see that? Does that work? H off, H on. That little button, just pressing that, where it says sync down here, turns on high-speed sync. It's no more complicated than that. And now, if I go to my camera and I go to my settings, I can now go past 200 and keep going to 2000. So high-speed sync allows my camera to operate its shutter mechanism far faster than it was ever designed to do. So very, very quickly, what is high-speed sync? So normally when you press the shutter, there is a curtain covering the sensor. Remember earlier I said you have to have the mechanical shutter. When you press the shutter, the curtain rises, exposes the sensor to light, and at the end of your shutter speed, a second curtain shuts it off. Boom, that's it. So two curtains, one, two. Go past your flash sync speed and the curtains travel in unison and your camera sensor is never fully exposed, meaning that your flash will light part of your image and part will be in shade from the sensor, from the shutter mechanism. It's really hard to demonstrate nowadays because modern transmitters don't allow you to make that mistake. But basically, part of your image would be missing. High-speed sync means that when you press the shutter, it pulses the flash really, really quickly as the shutter mechanism goes over the sensor, filling in all the little blanks as it goes. Unbelievably precise technology. And all you have to do is press a button. Right, that said, now all I need to do is actually work out the exposure and I've no idea what it's going to be. So let's pop it in 1/8 power. Here we go. A little bit bright. Yep, just a tiny bit bright. So maybe 1/16 power. There we go, that's pretty good. So now I have full control of the light. If you remember earlier, the light was coming in from the other direction. I've got my shallow depth of field, I've got my blurry background. Yes, high-speed sync in the studio, to answer your question from quite some time ago, is important. Okay, so if I go here, light's coming in from this side, this is the ambient light, whereas the last picture, which is right there, light's coming in from the other side. I've got control because I'm using flash. Okay, so high-speed sync in the studio, absolutely important. Other ways you could get around it, turn all the room lights off, then it wouldn't be an issue. Work in the dark, trip over your cable. But if you do trip over your cable, I've demonstrated what might happen. And that's with the lights turned on. Imagine how dangerous I'd be with the lights turned off. No need to answer that, anybody back there. It's all good. Okay. Right, so...
You ready for another question?
I'm ready for another question.
Okay. This is from Mosen Photos, who asked, what if I don't have a high sync flash? How can I take shots with low depth of field?
There you go. You need one of these.
We've had quite a lot of people actually mentioning ND filters. Okay. So there we go.
So to make high speed sync flash work, you need a couple of things. You need a compatible transmitter, a compatible flash, and a camera that's able to do it. I remember Nikon years ago, we had to turn FP flash, I think it was called, focal plane flash, on, and it was a bit of a nightmare. So you need everything to work. When it does, it's seamless and really easy. But
is that because they don't have mechanical shutters?
No, it was just because back then high-speed sync didn't seem to be a thing that was is required. It was like it was hidden away in a sub-menu. It was really hard to find and wasn't on by default. Nowadays, it's just like everywhere. It's just a thing. But the flashes, not all flashes have high-speed sync, not all transmitters have high-speed sync. Maybe you don't have a transmitter for the right camera, and there's a whole bunch of reasons. My transmitter will work on every camera, but actually including a Sony. We did try it on a Sony. So, but it won't work with high-speed sync on anything other than an Olympus OM system. So the solution, back to old-school stuff, which is a filter. So this is the solution. Let's just put that cable. I'm just going to move the cable. Just, you know.
Why would you do that?
I don't know why. Just
might be a
feel
little
the
late
urge.
For safety.
I don't think anyone noticed. Okay, so this is by chance a Hoya one. I didn't particularly choose Hoya brand. It was what was available because I've chosen the filter size and I wanted a 5-stop ND filter. If you're shooting around about f1.4, f1.2, and you normally shoot around about f8, f5.6, this is the one I would recommend in the studio. Not this exact one, that's strength of filter. So it screws on to the front of my lens, like this. Lovely. And then I can turn off high-speed sync, so I no longer have high-speed sync turned on, just to show you that. Okay, no high-speed sync, the little H is gone. And now basically I'm just in standard flash. So all I need to do is work out, well, my settings really. So I don't know, let's take a picture, find out. Lucky guess. There we go. I mean, total skill, not lucky guess. Total skill. So this is still at f1.2. This is still at f1.2. You can see by that really shallow depth of field, the fact that the back of Polly's hat is already getting soft, even though her eyes are sharp. So the solution is grab yourself an ND filter. Now the downsides, my viewfinder is a little on the dark side. Even though I've got the live view simulation turned on, I'm asking it to look through another 5 stops. So it's going to bump up the ISO of the screen, not the camera's settings, just the screen. It's not as clear as it normally is, but it works. It's good enough. And also I'm likely to forget that it's on. That's kind of a big thing. Try not to forget that you've got it on. Do take them off occasionally. So how do you make this work? There was another question about filters, wasn't there?
Yeah, I wasn't going to stop you because you were on.
No,
there,
but yeah, go, it's fine.
Yeah, there was another question. Jose Alberto Hernandez, 123, so I assume the other 122 had already got to the name first.
I mean, 123, that's a good number.
Yeah. Imagine being the 123.
Sure, you could have been 124 and that would have been just like...
It wouldn't work as well.
125 works.
Sorry. So the question, in today's digital world, is the use of filters still worth it?
Okay.
They mentioned that because they still use them.
So is it still worth having filters? I mean, yes. I rarely use this. The only time I actually use this is for demoing to you guys. It's the only time I use it because high-speed sync is just so easy to use. Most other filter effects we can replicate in post-processing. So it's a really good question. Is there still a purpose for filters? And the answer to that one is, yeah, absolutely there is. It's perhaps more refined than it used to be. So back in the day when I was learning darkroom photography and film and all that kind of things, I had a raft of filters for all sorts of effects. In fact, we did one recently on Adorama where I used a starburst filter, which I thought was a joke, and I thought I'd get absolutely lambasted in the comments for using a filter from, well, when I was younger, it was already a terrible filter. But no, it appears the youth of today have never found one of these things, and it's like, really? So yes, creating a starburst effect inside of the camera is very useful. I was watching what we were watching the other day. Richard Osman's House of Games, very UK program. The Champion of Champions, they had a gold trophy with little sparkly bits, and they'd used a starburst filter, so each of the sparkly bits had a little starburst off. It's like, oh yeah, they're using a starburst filter. So filters of all sorts are really useful. We did a demonstration at the photography show where I used a black mist filter for blending highlights and shadows together in camera. Look really good. So yes, very much so. And of course you can get fun filters. Anyone remember our Christmas unboxing? Random Christmas present, somebody bought me this. Right, look at that. Who wouldn't want this effect?
Yes, Biggie Z's just said that. Don't forget the half ring handheld thing you tested from Amazon.
Woo!
There's also another question while you're on the...
Yes, what am I on then?
Well, I don't know what you're on, but you were on.
I was on a roll.
So Lars asked, would the live ND on OM1 work?
But the live ND, no. So live ND on the OM1 Mark 1 and Mark 2, and also on the EM1 Mark 3, I can't remember, a whole bunch of cameras, is a... a computational thing that requires multiple exposures in the camera's silent mode. So it wouldn't work in the same way. You want a one-shot thing for this to work. It would work if you were doing continuous light. But because it takes multiple images, if your subject moved at all, you'd be completely stuck. So the short answer is no. Not for this job. So I'm just moving Polly around because I realised we could actually get a bit more blur in that background. We could just put a second flash in and we didn't cover that at all. There we go. I've still got the ND filter on. I've still got live ND, high-speed sync turned off. I've no idea what to make that back one. What I do need to do is work out the exposure on poly. Now, I could just take a trial and error, but there's another question, isn't there?
Oh yeah, that's me. yes, White Rectangle Photography has asked, is there any point using a light meter with a mirrorless camera?
Is there any point using a light meter? Short answer again, if you want a really quick answer, no, none at all. Don't need one. So why have I got two? Feel free to answer that in the comments.
Yeah, there is a similar question as well. So Gutami asked, what is the best way to get the right exposure with flash without a light meter? I rely on the histogram. Is that the right way?
Yep, okay, that's exactly the right way. So that is a brilliant answer to your own question, because if you rely on this, okay, if you rely on the screen to give you the correct exposure, what you're seeing and what I'm seeing are completely different. It's not auto exposure, so it's completely different. I can make that screen brighter, I can make that screen darker. It won't affect the exposure, but it will affect my perception of the image. So relying on the actual screen to give you an idea of your exposure is what everybody does. I do it, but it's a terrible idea. Much better, hang on a second, I have to press some buttons. Much better to have a look at the camera's histogram. And sorry to say, OM system has got one of the worst histograms I've ever.
It's quite pretty, though.
It is quite pretty, but it's. I'd like it reversed. I'd like the histogram to cover the entire screen and the image to be tiny, because that's what I'm really interested in. So I tend not to use the histogram on the camera, but it would be a much better option to do that. Also, if your camera has highlight peaking and shadow peaking, you can turn that on, so you'll get little blinky bits where your highlights are popping or your shadows are clipping. That can be useful as well. But just relying straight on the screen is not a good idea. So either look at the histogram or look at your shadows and highlights, or just take thousands and thousands of photos and learn what looks right is right, which is basically what I've done, I guess, over the years. Yeah, that was a good question. What was the other question? Light meters. Yeah, do you need one? I've got two. I've actually got probably four. I've got three of these over the years. I've collected, updated, and got new ones. Yeah, I use this.
You asked a question, actually.
Oh, did I ask a question?
Why have you got it?
Oh, did we get any answers?
We have some answers.
Is there actually anyone watching this?
There's some people watching. We'd like them to go and click the thumbs up, though. It would be great if you could do that.
Oh, we haven't done that, do we?
No,
oh, we should do that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we should definitely do that. Click on the thumbs up, click
Give
on the
some
like.
Love. So, Jay has said light meters are very accurate. Your LCD is not.
True.
Nate said ego.
Yes, again, right.
Mr. English Golfer, which I think is Steve. Why have a light meter? You can charge more.
Yeah, that's sort of true.
And then Jay had also said that he disagrees, that he thinks the histograms in most cameras are pretty useless.
Okay, I haven't tried most cameras, but I'll...
Biggie Z yeah. said, light meters make you look like a high society fancy man.
Oh, do they?
Apparently.
Oh, nice. I didn't know that. I'm adding that to my list. Okay, yeah, okay, there's three reasons I use a light meter. The first one, I'm just going to move the cable.
Well, there's another good comment actually as well from Gino, who says light meters measure ambient, cameras measure reflected.
Yeah, sort of true. Light meters do measure incident, so light falling onto your subject, where camera meters meter reflected light bouncing off your subject. So if your subject is wearing something really shiny and you're relying on the camera's TTL internal metering system, then you can get errors. Whereas light falling on your subject is the same, whatever color your subject is, whatever color they're wearing, whatever your subject is, the light falling on them is always the same, regardless of the subject. So yeah, you kind of got that right. The three reasons I use a light meter aren't necessarily those. Number one, it slows me down. Like a lot. Thinking time is absolutely vital. Thinking time is really, really good. So thinking time, and what am I going to do? Not quite sure. Oh, I know what I'm going to do next. It's marvelous. It's a wonderful tool for giving you thinking time. Consistency of results. Even if it's consistently wrong, your entire session will be have some sort of standard system that you're working to. So even if it's 2/3 of a stop out, at least you can fix all of them in one go in post-processing and you've got consistent results all the way through. And then, yeah, it does make you look better. There's no getting away from it. However you want to wrap it up, some people will feel if you have one of these, you must know what you're doing. You know, it's like having we had plumbers in recently. I had no idea what they were doing, but they had really good tools. I assume they did a good job. And it's the same kind of thing, really. It's kind of like, I don't know what they're doing, but they look like they know what they're doing, therefore I'm confident in their ability.
You mean they had a pencil behind their ear?
They didn't have a pencil behind their ear.
Oh, disappointing.
No, I lost a little bit of confidence when they started using WhatsApp to phone a friend to get some answers. I'll be honest with you. That did take a little bit of a tumble of confidence.
Just a little bit. It's fixed now, we think.
Oh, yeah, so, yeah. No, yeah. I have to say, whoever they phoned, brilliant answer. Got it fixed.
So, phone a friend, it's an option.
Phone a friend, yeah. Mm. Right, so, metering. I said I'd forget about the filter on the front. So here's the thing. I want f1.2. I can't make this tell me f1.2. And if I do, actually, maybe I can. Let's have a look. Can I make this tell me f1.2? No, because it's no longer flashing because I've turned it off remotely. Okay, I don't think I can even get this down to f1.2. If I go right the way down, the closest I can get is f2.5. So let's say f2.5 is close to f1.2. If I take this picture, here we go. Yeah, there's a bit of a problem because now my flash meter doesn't work at all. Because I've got this 5-stop ND filter on the front of my lens, what I'm metering here at f2 point whatever it was is not what I'm receiving because the ND filter is blocking that light. So if you are going to use the ND filter approach and you have a flash meter, there's two things you can do. Thing number one, maths. Anyone want to do some maths? Let's make the maths easy for you. Let's call it f1.4 instead of f1.2. 5-stop ND filter. What do I need this to tell me to get me the correct exposure having passed through the ND filter? All right, there's some maths for you whilst you're thinking about that. f1.4, I actually want to shoot at f1.2. In the middle, I've got a 5-stop ND filter. This is a hard question. No one's going to get that. The other way is just to put your ND filter over your cameras, over your flash meter's dome, okay, and then flash through that. Okay, so I would put that through there like that, flash through there, be that way around if so you could see it, but you'd get the idea. And then the light that hits the flash meter sensor is already down by 5 stops.
Okay. Would you like some answers?
Has anyone, someone's got an answer?
Yeah.
Go on then.
11? Sorry. Seems I've lost the
will
to speak.
Does your camera go all the way up to 11?
8. F8. F5.6. F8. Multiply by pi multiplied by trig divided by the power of 2. 7.1.
That's about right, isn't it?
Change by 4 stops if you want 1.4, actually 5.6.
Yeah, it's going to be in that area. All right, I've made it F8. So F1.4, one more stop would be F2, one more stop would be F2.8, one more stop would be F4, one more stop would be F5.6. Is that right? That sounds about right. So 1.4 to 2, 2.8, 4, 5.6. No, I missed one out. I knew I'd missed one. That didn't sound right. So yeah, it's going to be around about F5.6 or F8, depending on how good your maths are. So I'm going to guess F8. So let's make it F8. I think F8. Okay, so if I meter out and get this at F8, and I shoot at F1.4, remember, not F1.2, F1.4, there we go. Let's have a little look. Gets you in the ballpark, doesn't it? Close enough. There you go. Arguably, I might want to be a little bit brighter, F5.6. Either way, it gets you close enough. And sometimes close enough is okay.
You got a couple of other questions?
Yeah, good enough. Go for it.
So all I want to say is Adele for some reason. Not the singer. maybe you are.
I mean, we know she's a fan. We don't. We just
Hi, Gavin. If you don't have an ND filter, can I use 2 polarizing filters?
Oh, that's a good question. Mm. Yeah, I mean, yes, I suppose you could. I mean, I would keep them spotlessly clean. The more bits of glass you put in front, the more risk there is of a fingerprint or something causing some effects, and particularly flare. So if you were shooting with really kind of acute light coming in from the side here, your increased chances of flare go up the more bits of glass you've got in front of your lens before it hits the lovely anti-reflection coated.
Although that might look cool.
And you're absolutely right. Maybe that looks completely cool. Maybe it does look completely cool. Speaking of which, so you could. There's no reason why. The thing I would perhaps avoid are the variable ND filters. So have you seen those variable ND filters? I use them on video a lot, and they are ones which are basically two polarizing filters at 90 degrees, and as you rotate them, they become blacker and blacker and eventually go completely clear. The trouble with those is at a certain point, you'll get a cross appearing right through the middle of it if you go too far. So variable ND, I would probably avoid for that one and only reason. Let's just see if we can get some fun stuff. Let's see if it wants to focus through this. Okay, what? For those that didn't know what this filter does. Many faces of Polly. Yeah, fun. Okay. Oh, you missed the Christmas live. It was so much fun. Okay, good questions. Have we got any more?
One more question.
We've got one more question. Yeah, last question to finish off. That's good because we're right out of time.
Yeah, from SciFab Photo, who asks, what's the meaning of life without flash?
What is the meaning of life without flash? That's deep, isn't it? Yeah, it's a good question. If you're a studio-based photographer, back when I started, let's roll back to the late 1980s, flash, we'd had a camera club. We had a camera club portrait group. One side of the room was flash, and one side of the room was continuous, what were called hot lights. And they were called hot lights for a reason. They were red hot. No one wanted to use that side. Everybody wanted to use flash because of the massive benefits of using flash. However, the world has changed, and life without flash does actually have some meaning now, because if you weren't here right at the start, I can turn my flash off, take the transmitter off, and pop it into aperture priority mode for speed and convenience. Okay, and I can do a fairly good job. I might up my ISO a little bit. No one look at this. Nothing to see here. Nothing to see here. Okay, let's see. Take my ISO up a little bit. Because LED lights have become something of a bit of a game changer. Now the LED lights I've got in the room here are designed to light me, so they're not hugely bright. But we've done workshops with LEDs where I've got not only as good a results as I get with flash, but more creative, because LED lighting is, there's different ways of lighting with LED, different shapes, different styles of LED that you just don't get with flash. So by and large, I would say 90% of everything I'd ever want to do, I can do with flash. But that is shifting. So don't be surprised if over time you find yourself going, ah, maybe there is more to life than flash. Because we can actually do stuff with continuous light. And the early question about what if I don't have high-speed sync flash, I could have answered it just by saying, well, use the room lights. Because no flash, if you want a shallow depth of field, well, I can do that for you. No problem at all. Just using the room lights, right back where we started. So meaning of life without flash, yeah. Good question. Flash is not the only options. Right, okay, any other questions? Anything else I should know? Are we good?
Yeah, we've actually made a note of a couple of questions that people have put in, so perhaps for future sessions like this.
Awesome.
Or a video for Adorama. So thanks for all your questions. They've been really, really good.
Fantastic. So if you want more of this random stuff, hopefully a little bit more polished and hang on a minute, I'll just, and with a proper model, not Polly. Then Thursday, this week, this Thursday at, what time is it? 7 o'clock UK time? 7 o'clock UK time, which is 8 o'clock Central European time, which is 2 p.m. in Eastern time, and sometime on the West Coast. I have no idea what. A little earlier than that, I would imagine. We are going to be live on Adorama's channel. So not this channel, over on Adorama TV, and I'm going to be doing all stuff involving flash settings you need to know about, how to get the best out of them, and we've got the awesome Chloe coming in to model for that one. So hopefully you can come and join us for that one. Go over the channel now, hit the notify button, and you won't miss it. Okay, awesome. Like to thank, well, obviously thank you guys for watching. Polly for being an amazing model, as always. And Freya on the questions and doing the switcher and everything else.
Thanks, everyone.
Sam on the chat.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. And thanks for all your comments and your funny little... I like it. I like reading through everything. It's great. hopefully you'll join us on Thursday.
Yes.
When we do it all again, but slightly more professional.
Yeah. I'll try not to break anything on Thursday. Join me and find out if I do.
Try.
All right. Okay. So that brings us to the end of this live session. I'm Gavin Hoey. Thanks for watching.